413장 진행드리고 우리 수요 예배 겸 우리 수업을 함께 진행하도록 하겠습니다. 내 평생에 가는 길
내 평생에 가는 길 순탄하여 늘 잔잔한 강 같은지 큰 풍파로 무섭고 어렵든지 나의 영혼은 늘 변하다 내 영혼 평안해 내 영혼 내 영혼 평안해 삼키려고 입 벌리고 달려와도 주 예수는 우리의 대장 되니 끝내 싸워서 이기리라 It is well with my soul It is well It is well with my soul So this glorious thought My sin not in part But the whole To cross and I bear it no more Praise the Lord, praise the Lord Oh, my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul, and Lord, haste the day. When the faith
아니 이제 간주하고 가야 됩니다.
And Lord haste the day when the faith shall be sight the clouds be rolled back As a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall be saved. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well. With my soul It is well It is well With my soul
Amen 우리 수요 예배인데 예배 형식을 어떻게 취해야 될지 모르겠습니다만은 수요 기도를 대표 기도를 하실 분이 있으신가요? 그냥 바로 하면 되나요? 네 그럼 우리 한 찬송 넣어드리고 바로 이원기 목사님 나오셔서 예배 인도하시겠습니다. 우리 주님을 찬양하면서 우리 찬양하도록 하겠습니다. 주 안에 있는 나에게
주 안에 있는 나에게 단 근심 있으랴. 주자가 밑에 나가 내 짐을 풀었네. 주님을 찬송하면서 할렐루야 할렐루야. 내 앞길 멀고 험해도 나 주님만 따라가리. 그 두려움이 변하여 내 기도 되었고 전날의 한숨 변하여 내 노래 되었네. 주님을 찬송하면서 할렐루야 할렐루야. 내 앞길 멀고 험해도 나 주님만 따라가리. 주는 자비하셔서 늘 함께 계시고 눈금빛 밤을 아시고 늘 채워주시네. Singing I go along life's road, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. Singing I go along life's road, for Jesus has lifted my load. Singing I go along life's road, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. Singing I go along life's road, for Jesus has lifted my load. 주와 맺은 언약은 영불변하시니 그 나라 가기까지는 늘 보호하시네. 주님을 찬송하면서 할렐루야 할렐루야. 내 앞길 멀고 험해도 나 주님만 따라가리. Singing I go along life's road, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. Singing I go along life's road, for Jesus has lifted my load.
네, 우리 이봉기 목사님 나오셔서 우리 수협회뿐만 아니라 우리 알류 수업 계속해서 인도해 주시겠습니다.
It's great to see all of you. Let's turn our Bibles to Acts chapter 9. We'll read verses 1 through 9. Acts 9, verses 1 through 9. If you found it, we'll read it together in one voice. Let's have a responsive reading. I'll read one verse and you will read the next verse. Okay? Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 9. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest. Now as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." Then men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing the voice but seeing no one. And for 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Amen. We are continuing with our lecture, but this is also Wednesday service. Therefore, I want to share a short message as we go into our lecture. One of the things that we talk about theology is that people don't like theology. They're like, "I don't want to know theology. It's too academic. It's too brainy." But when we look at our lives, everything that we do is theology. The way we live, the way we worship, everything that we do connects to theology. But the point is, do you have the accurate and correct theology or wrong theology? What we see in Acts chapter 9 is Paul had a wrong theology, and there was a change in his theology, and he has a correct theology. Is there a before and after in your life after meeting Jesus Christ? Many people do not have before. Look at the people in this world. People have a clear before and after. Even people who don't believe in Jesus. You see that on television all the time. This is how I used to look, but after being on this diet, this is who I am. Before and after. Also, cosmetic surgery. I don't know if you know, Korea's best place to do it. So the thing that I heard was a lot of Chinese people will go to Korea to get their facelift. But the problem is they can't go back to China because their picture, passport picture, looks completely different from the actual person. So they need to do like DNA to get back to China. There is a clear before and after. But how about us as people who belong to this covenant journey? After meeting Christ in your life, is there a before and after? Paul, he thought he was persecuting the church for God because all these people who belong to Jesus are heresy. They're heretics. So Paul says, how dare they blaspheme God? So what happens? Paul executes them. He catches them. He throws them into prison, right? He's a forerunner, pioneer of this movement. But on the road to Damascus, he meets Christ. His life is completely changed. Better yet, he knelt before Christ, and his life was completely changed. As I look at this, I think about my life. I grew up in church all my life. And at age 12, I gave myself to the Lord saying, "I'm going to be a pastor." But no one told me about the gospel. They told me if you don't believe in Jesus, you go to hell. So their thing is, believe in Jesus, then you go to heaven. So I believe in Jesus to go to heaven, which is not wrong, but it's partial gospel. It's not the complete gospel. So here I am doing all my, with my zeal and with my heart, I'm serving God. Fasting at early age. You know, I have my own prayer closet, even though I'm not a Muslim. I had a closet. I had a prayer mat. You know, I said, "I'm going to be a man of prayer as a, you know, pastor." I would kneel down and pray. And, you know, I'll pray in tongues, to all different kinds of things. I'll read my Bible. No one told me to read my Bible like this, but because this is holy word of God, I'll kneel. Because this is holy. I can't just sit down and read. I need to kneel down. 10 chapters a day. One verse, one chapter is not enough. If I'm going to be a pastor that will be used by God, I'm going to read my Bible. 10 chapters a day. Taking notes. I didn't date in high school. It's not because I didn't, you know, want to or I can't. I had many girls lined up, but, you know, I said, no, I'm going to live for Jesus. I'm not going to date right now, right? So here I am, very, very active at church, fasting once a week, high school, from junior year to senior year. Every Friday, I didn't eat. I prayed because I thought this is how I please God. This is how I must live. But yet in my heart, doing all these things, I'm not happy. There's no true contentment. Paul says whether he has plenty or less, he's content in Christ. But me, I had no contentment. Even though I went to church every weekend, there's emptiness. And only thing that I see is from the preachers and all the leaders saying, you have to just sacrifice, carry your cross. You know, this is life. You suffer, and at the end, that's when Christ will come, wipe away all your tears, right? So here I am. Okay, then this is my burden. I'm carrying this burden, but there is no joy in my heart. I don't have assurance of salvation. How do I know that I'm saved? When my Sunday school kids would ask me, how do you know you're saved? I'm a leader, so I can't say, I don't know. That's bad. So I'll just say, you know. Like, how do you know? You know. You know, so that's my answer, but in my heart I'm like, oh my goodness, how do I know? And I'm not Pentecostal or full gospel, but I'm like, okay, because I pray in tongues, I got to be saved. There's no assurance of salvation. I said life is difficult, but it's okay because I love God. I'm going to just sacrifice my life. At that very moment I was actually caught in a dilemma, because I told you I wanted to be a pastor. I see all my friends being addicted to alcohol, drugs, and, you know, their life is falling apart. They're asking me, what should I do, Brian? Can you help me? So I tell them, only thing that I could say to them is, go to church. And then one of my friends got really upset, and he started yelling and cursing. Don't you think I want to go to church? I can't go to church because I'm so dirty. I have to get my life straight, and then I'll go to church. When I heard that, I couldn't give any answer. That was like the most embarrassing moment in my life. I can't give the answer to people. So I remember my freshman year in college, every morning I cried out to the Lord, God, if you want me to be a pastor, I need to be able to give the answer to the people. I need answers, and I could give the answers to other people. I cried in tears and prayed sincerely, because I didn't think of anything else. I said, I'm going to be a pastor no matter what. And after a year later, I was at a lock-in, this lock-in, and the speaker proclaimed this message, Matthew 16, 13 through 20. You are the Christ, the Son of living God. My prophet, perfect way for me to meet God, because my problem is separation from God. We're alienated from God. And sin and curse, and Satan. When I heard this, I realized that Christ is my prophet, priest, and king. This is who I've been missing in my life. So the moment I received Christ, knowing who Christ is, my life has never been the same. It's not that, hey, I'm going to live it, I'm going to live with my might and power. No, at times I fall. At times, I go away or astray. But God always brings me back. See, my life has been changed by God's grace. Has your life been changed in the covenant of God? This afternoon, I had the opportunity to eat lunch with our Pastor Lee. And it's funny because I first met Pastor Lee when I began this gospel movement, 21. And he was like 35. And, I mean, he still looks like he's in early 40s. And, you know, it's amazing. And just talking to him and just, you know, thinking about throughout 30 years of this remnant movement, how God has been using us, how God has been using the One Mind Church. I'm so blessed to see so many all nations disciples gathered here. This is the model. This is what all the remnant churches need to receive. Then we could save this America. And here I am just thinking about, just looking at the past for 30 years, how God's hand has been faithful over my life. There is a before and after in my life. Look at Paul. Here his name was Saul, but as you know, it changes to Paul. Because he can't go back to his old ways. He met Christ. So what does he do? In this very moment, he said he didn't eat anything. He didn't sleep for 3 days. Can you imagine? This God, Jesus I was persecuting, he is the Messiah. I met this Messiah. He couldn't go to sleep. He was shocked. And he heard this gospel, received Christ, and his life was completely changed. What happens? Paul now lives for Christ. We see in the later verse, he proclaimed that Jesus is the Christ. What does he do? He dies for Jesus. He dies for the body of Christ. The doctrine that we're looking at in our systematic theology throughout the semester is the doctrine of the church. Paul loved Jesus, therefore he loved the church. So Saul, who persecuted the church, dies for the church. I pray that you and I will be remnants who will die for our church. If we have that kind of heart and mentality, God will use our church for world evangelism. That's the reason why we live. And this is the reason why we study theology. Not just for brain and head knowledge, but it has to be real in our fields. It has to save people. It has to raise disciples. It has to establish and strengthen the church. Amen? Amen. So that's what we looked at so far. And here we're going to go on and continue with our lecture. And what we're looking at here today are the sacraments. Before we do that, before we took a break, we were seeing this picture, video together. Can we play that? Presentation, yes. Don't just look at that and say that's animal cruelty, because all the farmers have that. And what that does is actually seals the animal, saying this is mine. This belongs to me. So when we're looking at baptism, that's what took place. When we're baptized into Christ, Christ put a seal over our head. What? We belong to Jesus. When Jesus sees us, he sees the seal. That's what Paul says, that we have this Holy Spirit as our seal. Amen? So let's look at Lord's Supper. This lecture will combine our 11th and 12th together. So let's look at the Westminster Confession of Faith, and let's read this out loud together. Our Lord Jesus, in the night wherein he was betrayed, instituted the sacraments of his body and blood, called the Lord's Supper, to be observed in his church unto the end of the world, for the perpetual remembrance of the sacrifice of himself in his death, the sealing of benefits thereof unto true believers, their spiritual nourishment and growth in him, their further engagement in and unto all duties which they owe unto him, and to be a bond and pledge of their communion with him and with each other as members of his mystical body. So we're talking about the communion. It's like baptism. The ordinance is instituted by Christ, because that's what he does, Lord's Supper, right? And to observe till the last day. He says, remember this and observe this before I return. So this communion has past, present, and future aspects. Past, remembering his death. So every time we take the Lord's communion together, we think about what Christ has done for us. We remember the suffering that he suffered, but he resurrected, right? He is with us, present. We receive nourishment. God says, go and make disciples. Do world evangelism. But the most amazing and the beauty about this is We don't do it with our power. We do it from God's power, power from above. With that, we could conquer the world. The world says it's impossible, but everything is possible in Christ. All the impossible becoming possible in Christ for the purpose of world evangelism. We get spiritual nourishment. Every Sunday, I pray that you will receive the greatest spiritual nourishment through worship. And greatest spiritual nourishment in One Mind Church as you celebrate the Lord's table together. Remembering what Christ has done for me, and He is continuously providing for me. That's why we say Jehovah Jireh, our provider. Future, we anticipate His coming. You know, we cry out world evangelism, but for what? You know, we cry out so much, world evangelism, right? But por qué, right? Why? Poquito habla español, right? Por qué, why? Because why? The last day, when we'll be all gathered together in the name of Christ, with all believers, all lives from past and now, belonging together to worship God. That's the reason why we evangelize. So we anticipate His coming. And we'll talk about this two important things through the doctrine of eschatology starting from tomorrow. But here, present nourishment comes by feeding on Christ. And this is the imagery that we see in the Bible. It's not just God will provide. We feed on Christ. Also by close relationship with other in the body of Christ. It's fellowship. It's not just us and Christ, but it's also the body of Christ. Excuse me. A means of grace. God equips us to better serve Him. God strengthens us, equips us, and provides for us so that we could do this world evangelism. That's what we see in the book of Joshua. God tells Joshua, I'll be with you as I was with Moses. Let my words not depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. Be bold and courageous. So it seems like, okay, Joshua's going to do it. No. Who goes before Joshua? God. The Ark of the Covenant splits the Jordan River apart. Jericho walls fall. Sun and moon hold still. We see this amazing work of God taking place. What does that remind us here today? This world evangelism, God's going to do it. Raising up the future generation, all nations, God's going to do it with His power. Through who? Through you and I. Through the church. Through One Mind Church. Through the body of Christ. Right? So, we'll go into this more in detail. What does this sacrament, as we look at the blood and the wine, the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, what does that really mean? And why is it so important? So let's look at the Catholic side, because Catholics do this all the time. So we'll show a small, short clip about this. Can you play that for us?
An important part of the Mass is called the Communion Rite. Just before the Communion Rite, you and the rest of the congregation kneel. You're kneeling for the most solemn part of the Mass, the consecration. At every Mass, you will prayerfully watch as the priest consecrates the bread and wine. He consecrates them so they can become the body and blood of Christ. This is a miracle called transubstantiation. After the consecration, the sacred host and precious blood look, feel, and taste like bread and wine, but they're not. They are the body and blood of Christ. Often bells are rung when the priest elevates the host, and again when he elevates the chalice. The ringing of bells at the consecration calls our attention to this amazing moment of the Mass when Jesus is truly present in the Eucharist. We will soon come forward to receive this blessing in Holy Communion. When the priest elevates the host and then the chalice, we silently pray to ourselves, my Lord and my God. The communion rite comes right after the consecration. It begins with the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father. Jesus taught this prayer to His disciples when they asked Him how to pray. In this prayer, we join together to pray for the coming of God's kingdom. We ask God to provide for our needs, forgive our sins, and bring us to the joy of the kingdom of God. When you pray this prayer, follow along with your family and the priest. They'll show you how the prayer is prayed in your parish. So after the Lord's Prayer, which is the Our Father, we share a sign of peace with one another. The celebrant prays that the peace of Christ will be within us, be within our community, within our church, within the entire world. So this is a sign of hope that we share with one another, and we use words as well as gestures to share a sign of peace. We shake hands with people, or if there's someone close to us, we might give them a hug as we say the words, "Peace be with you." We can share a sign of peace with each other right now, okay? Peace be with you.
May peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Good. Go ahead and sit back down. After the sign of peace, the priest breaks the host as we sing the Lamb of God. In Latin, this is called the Agnus Dei. The action of breaking the host reminds us of the actions of Jesus at the Last Supper when he broke bread before giving it to his disciples. Before receiving Holy Communion, the priest and the congregation together admit their unworthiness to receive so great a gift as Jesus. We pray our souls are healed. The priest receives Holy Communion first. He then gives it to those who will help you receive it, the extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion. Sometimes the choir receives communion next, before the congregation.
So that's how Catholics do their communion service, and it sounds very Christian, but we have to see that there's wrong theology in this. They call this transubstantiation, where after priests consecrate the bread and the wine, they actually become the physical body and the blood of Christ. So what they believe is that during the ceremony, the priest will bless the bread and the wine, and he will pray, and there will be a bell, actually. It rings. As soon as it rings, what takes place is the bread becomes actual body of Christ. And the wine becomes actual blood of Christ. It's actual blood and the body of Christ. That's what they say. So though they still appear to be bread and wine, supper is continual sacrifice of Christ's body and blood. So if they believe that this is actual body of Christ and blood of Christ, they're sacrificing where God is sacrificing Christ over and over and over again. That's where the problem is. This is wrong. Because the death of Christ is what? Once and for all, right? You don't need any more sacrifice. So with this mindset, it will give a way for all these Roman Catholics to realize that there's works involved with faith. So Jesus said, "This is my body." He cannot have meant that body and blood on the table was his literal body. Even because Catholics say, Jesus said, "This is my body." But as you know, when Jesus said, "This is my body," his actual body was behind the table. So the wine and the bread cannot be the real body. So bread and wine represent his body and blood. A major problem here is a continued sacrifice of our Lord. Right? Jesus' atonement is final and complete. Some Catholics will say this: if you sin, you're crucifying Jesus again. That's very wrong. He's crucified. He has resurrected, right? No continuation, once and for all. So first century Rome said Christians were accused of crime of cannibalism because they said we are eating the body of Christ and blood of Christ. They're like, what kind of, you know, religious group is this? They said they're cannibals. So evidence that the idea of real continuation or connection between bread and flesh, wine and blood is very important. So Catholics, their continual sacrifice is wrong, but let's look at here Lutheran view, okay? Lutheran view is important because it stays in the middle of Catholics and Protestants. Let's look at what Luther says, and we'll look at this short clip, about 3 minutes.
Jesus said, "This is my body, this is my blood."
That's where the conversation has to start. He didn't say, this represents my body. He didn't say, this represents my blood. Now, of course, other Protestants will say Jesus was speaking in figures. Jesus was using a metaphor. Well, Jesus was known to use metaphors on occasion, so this is possible. But it's not something that the Christian church ever believed until the Reformation, when some whole groups of Christians, some whole sections of the church began believing this and teaching this, which is something that I think Protestants do not give nearly enough thought to. Yes, we follow the word of God rather than the traditions of men, but if the whole church of God received the word of God to mean a certain something for the first 1500 years, maybe that's what it meant to them in their own language, in their own day, these people who were closer historically and linguistically to Christ and the apostles when they taught these things. But we don't have to just think of it in that sense, an argument from tradition and history. We normally use reasoning, probabilistic reasoning, to determine when somebody is speaking literally and when somebody is using a metaphor. So when your child comes home from the Little League game and says, we got killed, we just got killed out there, it was a slaughter, you don't say, oh, I'm so glad you're alive, did all your teammates die? How did you escape? You know that that's a metaphor because Little League teams don't kill each other. But when Jesus says, this is my body, this is my blood, how do you know it's a metaphor? He doesn't say it's a metaphor. None of the apostles ever say it's a metaphor. How do you know it's a metaphor? He's God. It can be his body. It can be his blood. This is not too hard for him. He can certainly do it. And most Protestants that I have talked to about this, they recognize, well, yeah, of course, he could do it. He just didn't. Well, how do you know he didn't? Saying the Catholics believe he did is not a good argument. Jesus Christ could do it. And in fact, if we have the Old Testament in mind, we have reason to think that maybe that was in fact what he meant, that he was speaking literally. It was a Passover meal. Jesus was having the Passover with his disciples. He took the Passover meal and he repurposed it as the Lord's Supper. Every time we eat the Lord's Supper, we are eating the Pascha. We are eating the Passover meal of the Christian church. And what did they do at a Passover meal? They ate the body of the lamb that had saved their lives from the final plague in Egypt. They ate the Passover lamb. So Jesus, at the end of a meal where they ate the Passover lamb, Jesus, who was about to die as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, as the final sacrifice, as the fulfillment of the Passover and every other sacrifice in the Old Testament, said, "This is my body, eat it." That's some pretty strong context. And it's context that is ignored. People don't think about the Old Testament context at all. So often when they look at this, they just say, oh, if that were literal, that would be too weird. It's not a good argument. Jesus is the sacrifice, and the Passover was not the only sacrifice by a long shot in the Old Testament that was eaten. A portion of it was eaten either by the priests or sometimes by the priests and the one who brought the offering in the first place. And that was part of the rite. We do not believe in a Lutheran church, as they do in a Roman Catholic church, that we offer up the body of Christ as a re-offering, as a representation of his offering that he made to God the Father on the cross. But we do believe, basically, that we arrive at the scene right after he offered himself for the second half of the sacrifice, and that is the meal, where we, as the royal priesthood of God and as the beneficiaries for whom he gave his body and blood, partake of his body and blood as he in fact told us to do.
So what we just saw is Lutheran view. And Lutherans say, hey, Catholics say this is actual body of Christ and blood. And in a way, that's right. That's what Jesus says in the Bible. You can't say it's not, but it's not a continual sacrifice. So they come to this middle point, which is very interesting. And their argument goes like this, midway between Roman Catholic and Reformed, they teach that in the sacrament, Jesus' physical body is in, with, and under. Okay? Again, in theology, you use a lot of terminology. So in, with, and under. Elements are still bread and wine. When you look at the bread and wine, it's bread and wine. But Jesus' body and blood are there too. Interesting, huh? So they say he is present. That's why Martin Luther says, the meaning of the word is here. Where is here the body of Christ? It says it is here in this bread and wine. And he says this in Latin, hoc est corpus meum, meaning this is my body. Jesus said this is my body. So somehow God's presence has to be there. They deny the Roman Catholic idea of the sacrament as a continuing sacrifice. Because, again, that's very wrong. However, their emphasis on a literal physical presence of Christ. They emphasize there still has to be presence of Christ. It dilutes the biblical emphasis on receiving Christ by faith alone. That's the problem. So Lutheran view is not the view that we hold on to. But Ulrich Zwingli, who is another reformer, he said sacrament is only a sign. That's it, just a sign. Nothing else. Only a memorial. You know, like wedding ring. Sorry, I don't wear my ring because it's really, you know, it annoys me. So people think I'm still single. But yes, I'm married and I have two kids. But, you know, why do you have ring? Memorial. It's a sign that I'm married, right? So they say just doing this is just memorial of what Christ has done for us, right? But this is what John Calvin says. No, it's not just a sign or a memorial. There's something special about this. There's something special when we follow Jesus' command and celebrate this Lord's table. He says, supper is not a mere memorial, but means of grace. Again, means of grace is what God strengthens us with as we continue this covenant journey to do his works, to live for the kingdom of God. Why do we fail so much as remnants? Because we don't receive God's strength. Yes, Jesus Christ has finished it all, and he says he is with us, but the problem is we try to work with our own strength and with our own power. What happens? We live in the cycle, right? We say, Jesus, yes, that's right, you're my Christ. And then you go back to your old ways, try to do it with my power and my strength, and when you get beat up, that's when you say, Lord, I need you, I'm sorry, you're my Christ. But you get up. And what happens? You fall back. So it's like a cycle over and over and over and over. Remember Pastor Yu, he said RCA, I know we're going to have RCA this year. Every time we see the skit, it's the same thing. Remnants struggling, but somehow they receive grace and they come alive, right? Every year it's talking about the same thing. So he's like saying, how long are we going to do this? We have all the answers. We have the complete gospel. How long are we going to be defeated? God has called you and I in this covenant journey to conquer in the name of Jesus Christ. Why are we losing? Why are we living in this cycle? Because we're not receiving the daily grace. We're not receiving the means of grace that God has provided for us. We're talking about the Lord's table, but before this is the Word of God. If we receive God's Word as my strength, then we can overcome. Actually, again, when we say evangelism for us is word movement. The word of God is living and active, sharper than the double-edged sword. I pray that the word of God will be alive in you every day. Means of grace. Not by my strength, but yes, God is with me. How do we know? By his word. Right? So he promises. This is means of grace. When we take the supper, Christ is present in the spirit. So this is what Calvin says. Look, this is really important because Jesus commanded us. Yes, bread and wine, but yes, there is presence of Christ through the Spirit. The Spirit of God is in us, right? So the Spirit of God dwells during this time more in this communion. And it says, so we participate in his body and blood. In 1 Corinthians 10, 16, 18. And the verse that we read, John chapter 6, 53, 58. We feed on him. That's awesome imagery that we find in the Bible. It's not just eating, right? But as we take the blood and the wine, we're feeding on Christ, on what Christ has done for us through the cross. So these benefits come by faith alone. Nothing else, not by works, by faith. The moment I believe, the moment I hold on to the covenant, God begins to break down all the forces of darkness. The moment I hold on to the covenant, God gives me strength. The physical body of Christ is in heaven. right? As we look at theological truth, is that Christ is not present here physically, spiritually. But now, if he is there physically, think about this. Reflect on the past, the present, and the future. Right? When we do the Lord's table together, we always think about the past, of what Christ has done for us, present, how he's nourishing us, future, what we're living for. And remember Christ in his death, thanking him for his complete salvation. I believe Jesus, when he said it is finished, everything has been finished on the cross of Christ. That's the thing that I see every time I see my problems. Because we face problems. But in the midst of the problem, Christ has finished it all. I was talking to this one girl that I shared the gospel to, and she's actually from Peru. And she was adopted when she was 3 months old. She's raised by Caucasian parents in Maryland. And basically, she doesn't know who her parents are. And she came to America, grew up like all other American kids. The foster parents were like the real parents to her, provided everything that she needed. And basically, in high school, she fell into depression, bipolar depression. She says, like one day, she sees black figures like running around the room. She's hearing voices. And she has this some kind of, panic attack where she starts scratching herself. So when she scratches, like, you know, you see all the skin coming off and there's blood. She actually had this episode in front of me in church. Like, she starts hitting herself and she starts scratching, scraping herself. And, you know, she's doing this continuously. But she heard the gospel. She accepted Christ. She said, this is the reason why I need Christ. She said, Jesus is my prophet, priest, and king. And she confessed and accepted Christ into her heart. But the problem is, she still struggles with this. It doesn't go away. So, you know what? Before I even said anything to her, she goes, you know what, Pastor Brian? It's okay, because I have Jesus. In the midst of this, Christ is with me. For this, I have Jesus. I am so thankful. Do we see the power of the gospel? When Jesus says it is finished, it is finished. How do we overcome drugs, alcohol, all different kinds of things? You can't do it with your power. That's why Christ has done it for you. You look to the cross and you realize it's over. Because Christ is the perfect sacrifice. Perfect ultimate sacrifice. He has made the perfect way for us to meet God. God and I, we belong together. We're with him, right? The throne, we have the direct access to the throne. He has completely washed our sins, removed our sin, like the song we sang, right? All of our sins has been nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Why do you bear it, though? The problem is, why do you keep on bearing those burdens? It's over, right? And Satan, Satan is so clever. He knows that if people of the covenant receive strength, he knows that God will use them. So what does he do? 24 hours, he's like a roaring lion, ready to devour, so that we won't receive God's grace, so that we will lose hold of the gospel. He works so hard. But the moment you call upon the name of Christ and resist the devil in his name, he flees. We have this awesome victory and true freedom. But the thing is, our standard of freedom is this world freedom. God has set you free completely from all the bondage of sin and Satan. As we hold on to this truth, we realize that we could overcome all the sickness and all the Satan's obstacles, because it has been finished. It is finished. So that's one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It's not because it's short, right? I remember, like, retreats, like growing up, you have to memorize verses to eat. So if you don't memorize verses, you can't eat. So people memorize it, right? But it's not because it's short, but it is finished. Jesus said it. That's what we're remembering. Present, right?
nourishment. We're going to look at this more in detail before we finish. But remember Christ in his death, thanking him for his complete salvation. Salvation is not future. It happened the moment we accepted Christ. The supper is called Thanksgiving. That's why Catholics call it Eucharist, but also this is biblical terminology. One of the things that I see is that all these people who don't have the true gospel, they use good terminology. Like Jehovah's Witness, that's actually a good word, right? Watchtower, or even Eucharist. But in our theology, we do use this terminology, but Eucharist simply means Thanksgiving. Look, Catholics, every Catholic church you go to, you have Jesus hanging on the cross. Every time you go. And I don't know if you are bothered by this, but he's not there anymore. Yes, he died. He suffered. But he's not there anymore. He's risen. He's sitting on the right hand of God, and he is in our hearts. But to Catholic, he is sacrificing his life continuously. That's why it's not the gospel. We can't say, oh, that sounds very similar, so it has to be some kind of... No, it's not the gospel. Christ has risen. When we talk about our spiritual state, for me, when I receive Christ into my heart, it's not because I realize Christ and then I receive them. I actually realize my spiritual state. I realize that my problem is being separated from God and being under curse and wrath of God and under Satan's authority. That's when I was doomed. I realized I'm doomed. Who could deliver me from this state? And we simply say we accept Jesus Christ, but think about what happened here. This spiritual state that we're all in cannot just disappear. Because theologians said, hey, God is God, so he could do it in a different way. He could just make it go away. No, he cannot make it go away because he is righteous God. So he is righteous God, so there has to be a penalty paid for our sin and curse. Who took the sin and curse? Jesus Christ. Better yet, who made the way for us? God did. God sent his only son. If God didn't send his son, there's no way. And he died for us. It was an excruciating, painful death that Jesus did for us so that we could have life in Jesus. He suffered so that we don't have to suffer. So Christ has resurrected. He doesn't hang on the cross. Okay? So in the present, we can gain spiritual nourishment only from Christ, nothing else. What makes your heart pump? And what gets you excited? Because as I said, I watch like a lot of sporting events. People go crazy. I mean, they say actually sports is God, and I believe it. Like my boys are playing sports, and if they want to get serious, they have to play on Sundays. Then you can't go to church. So thank God, somehow it's been working out, so they're not missing church. But when you go to sporting events, have you been to sporting events? Please go. They're singing worldly songs. But they're all locked in arms together, singing. You saw the World Cup. See the flag? There's goosebumps. You know, why do you cry when someone scores? Goal. We're crying, jumping up and down. But, even me, I grew up here in America in my life. When I saw the Korean World Cup, I mean, there's something deeper. I mean, this is different from, like, watching football or baseball. There's something deep, because, I know where I belong. But even looking at this, we look at sporting stadiums. People are more alive than people in church. People in church, they're just, so, like zombies, I guess. Their eyes are moving. But you could tell as pastor, like, you guys are thinking about something else. I know that you're daydreaming, right? Or like, as you're sitting down, especially in like Korean church, you just hear pin drops or AC running, heater running, right? Thanks to our All Nations Disciples of this church. It's been a great week so far. Hearing response back, amen and all these stuff. But think about it. Even though if I was a non-believer, I don't want to be in church. You go to sporting events, you're more excited. You're moved to tears. There's joy. There's cheering. You want to be moved, watch Korean dramas. They make it so good. You watch it, and before they end, they make it in a way so that you will watch the next one. At the end, you're like, oh my gosh, what's the next episode? I have to watch it. So what are you thinking? The drama starts on Monday, so if it's Tuesday, I got 5 more days to go. That's your time schedule. Like, you don't set it on Sunday worship or, you know, other events, but it's drama. Next Monday is this drama. And you stay all excited throughout the week. What's that episode going to, you know, show me? You know, what are they going to do? What's going to happen to this couple? It's always the same thing, love triangle. But anyways, you know, you get excited. You're anticipating, right? Do you anticipate the word of God? When Pastor Lee is about to preach the message on Sunday, are you ready to receive God's word? When Pastor Dexter preaches and proclaims the gospel, are you ready to receive? Are you excited when you hear the word of God? Do you really see the answer? Not just memorizing, oh, because I have to write it down. No, do you really receive the answer on Sundays? Have this attitude. Until I receive the answer, I will not leave this building. Every Saturday, that's why I tell my members, pray every Saturday night. Lord, speak through your servant. Lord, let tomorrow be the most amazing Sunday worship. Bless the praise team. Bless all of our members. What bothers me is when people receive grace, there are people who don't receive grace. They're always stuck in their disbelief. That breaks my heart. So what you pray the night before, Lord, let everyone in One Mind Church receive God's greatest grace. Let us be one with your word tomorrow. There's a difference. But we don't anticipate. We come 1 hour. Pastor Lee's going to preach for about an hour. Okay. Tell me something new. Right? Okay. All right. Okay. I got it. Right? You just walk out. It's just a ritual. We just do this weekly thing. But no, gospel is not ritual. It's Jesus' life, Jesus' power. It's real, right? Let us truly experience this living God through the power of God's word. And that's one of the ways that we do experience God's power through the sacraments, Lord's table. So some churches do this every week. I think that's a little too much. Some Presbyterian churches, they do it once every quarter. But it's something that we must do continuously as we think about the gospel. So by eating and drinking, participating in his body and blood, we sense a greater union with him. It's really amazing as we gather together, holding on to God's covenant, confirming, right, receiving God's grace of what Christ has done for us. So John Calvin says, emphasize that Christ is not physically present in the supper, but live physically in heaven. That's because Christ is physically in heaven, not here. Then what? Not so much Christ coming to be with us, but Calvin says, we're going up to heaven as we partake the Lord's table together. We're being sent up to heaven to be with him. We join him in the heavenly places. That's different about our communion. And here we are, future. We look forward to the greater banquet to come. Because Jesus says what? Do this in remembrance of me. Right? Until what? I come back. And we wait for that greater banquet. Wow, I wait for that moment. I lost many loved ones throughout this past few years. But many of them, I know that they had Christ. And there are times I had to do funerals, lead funerals. And every time I look at the family or even myself, it's sad losing someone that you love. But every time I'm in the burial, as I stand over the cemetery, I look forward to that moment when everyone will rise. People who belong to Christ will be lifted up to heaven. But people who don't believe in Jesus, they'll be condemned to hell. And we have to see that there will be many nice people in hell. Because you're nice, that doesn't mean you're going to go to heaven. You have to know Christ. You and I, we belong to that Christ. So we anticipate for that moment, that glorious day when there will be no more pain and suffering, where we will worship the Lord, Holy, 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 God Almighty, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for our sins. That's the time that we're looking for. You know, after this is over, I'm going to go home at the end of the weekend. I can't wait. I don't like traveling too much, right? And I like just being at home. And, you know, I can't wait. But what the Word of God says is that one day we'll be all living together. And I don't know if that's a good thing, but we'll be all living together forever and ever and ever and ever. I told my son Jaden when he was a baby, I was like, what's heaven like? I told him, we're going to live forever. So he was having a nightmare when he was sleeping, and he's crying, I don't want to be stuck in heaven. I don't want to be stuck in heaven. He doesn't understand what heaven is, right? We don't understand. But it's the most glorious place. Jesus that we've been hearing about, we will see him face to face. We will see Moses. We will see Elijah. We will see Paul. This is what we're looking for, great banquet. Our fellowship with Christ is this life cannot begin, in this life cannot begin to compare with the glory that awaits us in him. This is why Matthew 24:14, gospel will be proclaimed to the ends of the earth. That's when Christ will return. Right now, there's rumors of war. We see actual war taking place in Ukraine, Russia, Israel, Hamas. We see earthquakes, famine. Don't be scared, because that's not the end. The end is when this gospel is proclaimed to the ends of the earth. Through who? Through you and I. Through the remnants, through the covenant people. I'll close with this. As I share continuously, this is an amazing thing to be used by God. My life being used for the kingdom of God. There's no greater blessing than this. We have to realize that this is something that we cannot change with anything in the world. Jesus, when he resurrected, he is the Almighty God. He could have finished it all. He could have just evangelized the whole world and the kingdom could have just come. But when the disciple says, is this the time? Jesus says, no, it's not this time. It's not for you to know. But you will see power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. This amazing, wonderful work of God, God's not going to accomplish it on his own. He wants to use you and I. He wants to use the One Mind Church. To me, that is the greatest blessing. I cannot trade anything for this calling that God has given to me. That's why Paul says he considers everything rubbish compared to knowing Christ. I pray that you and I will be those disciples as we continue in this covenant journey and as we continue as remnant university students. Amen? God bless you. All right? Let's pray together at this time. If we could pray just for a few minutes holding on to today's word, just thinking about, once again, the importance of the sacrament. It's all gospel. It's all Christ. Let's pray, Lord, fill us with your love, assurance, of the sure covenant that Jesus is the Christ. Right? But use our lives, use our One Mind Church, use all the remnant students who are taking this course so that they could stand as an evangelism disciple. Let's pray together at this time. And we thank you. We give all the glory to you, for you are the Christ. And we give all the glory and power. Pray that you will strengthen us more and more day by day. Yes, we're weak, but Father, we look to you because you are almighty. Father, I pray that you, God, will guide us more by more, that you, God, will lead us into victory in your name. Lord, Father, not by ways, but your ways, O Lord. God, we pray that as we continue on with this message, as we continue on with this great law, pray that your God will guide us so that we may not fall. Lord Jesus, in the name of Christ, we pray that your God will spread more by more by your mercy and power. Pray that you will, Lord, lead us and guide us. Sacraments, Lord God, I pray that you, Lord Jesus, thank you, Father, God, Jesus. God, we thank you so much once again for your word. We think about the gospel as we see the three aspects of our present and past and future completely finished in Christ. Father, we pray that you, O God, will continuously guide us, strengthen us as we hold on to the means of grace that you provide for us, the word of God and the Lord's table. And as we think about the importance of baptism, As we have died with you, we have risen. We're united with you. Lord, help us to enjoy this gospel to the fullest. And we pray, Lord, that you, O God, will be with all of our remnant students and all the One Mind Church members, so that they may be able to stand as your living witness and for the kingdom of God. We give all the glory to you in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.